I grew up in Miami, a section of Miami called Opa-locka. In the 80s, it was at one point, I think per capita, the murder capital of the United States. Growing up in Miami during the Miami Vice 80s, when I was 9, I knew what a Rolex Presidential was and how much it cost. And I knew that I would never have one working like my parents did. I was drawn to the streets. And I was a different person then. I was a young man looking for direction. And, you know, I didn't have what I needed. I ended up kind of coordinating a major heist. Somebody came to me and said, hey man, I got something you might be interested in. The plan is to rob a cruise ship. I mean, when I sat down and looked at the plan, I was like, man, this is doable. My father, who was in law enforcement, he convinced me to turn myself in. After spending a year in the county jail, I ended up making a plea bargain for a sentence of 18 and a half years, of which I served 9 and a half. It was at the Opa-locka Work Release Center where I met a correctional officer named Primetime Daryl D. And he opened the door to professional wrestling for me. I had asked Primetime, like, hey man, how do you guys like do that without really breaking each other's necks? You know? And he said, when you get out, if you want to learn, I'll teach you. I needed a hobby, something to keep me out of trouble. And I was like, yeah, all right, sure. So a few months after I got out, he called me up, asked me if I still wanted to train. I said, yeah. He said, all right, man, you did a long ride. You know, just enjoy life for a little bit. I'll call you in a few months. If you're still interested, we'll start. So he ends up bringing me to Duke the Dumpster Drozzi's wrestling school. And who's the head trainer? Soul Man Alex G. He brought me to Soul Man Alex G. Said, hey, man, this dude just got out of prison. We met in the joint. Soul Man Alex G trained me as a favor. I never paid a dime for wrestling school. So it was kind of like fate, you know, it was my destiny.
Oh, is the camera on? Oh, you want to hear something from me? No problem, check this out. With talent on loan from God, standing before you is a world-class athlete extraordinaire. My name is Montel Vontavious Porter.
I got out of prison in July of 99, and I signed my developmental deal with WWE in October of 05. I was in Deep South and just outside of Atlanta, and they saw my passion and my earnestness. Norman Smiley was a guy who really helped me out a lot. You know, he molded me, devoted a lot of time and effort into nurturing my talent.
Montel Vontavious Porter find out where he's been skilled in the art of pro wrestling, because he's taking it to a woman on Ray Gordy.
Worked really hard, and when I got the word that I was being called up, it was like, okay, wow, this things got real, really fast. This isn't developmental, you know, this isn't TV in a little warehouse. Now you're sharing the stage with The Undertaker, with Kane, you know. Okay, all right. When I was told that my very first rival would be with Kane, it was surreal, you know, like Monday Night Raw, Friday Night SmackDown.
Because I am the highest paid athlete.
Oh, you're the highest paid athlete. Who cares? You know what that means to me? That. The United States champion. What a throw by MVP.
Ah, come up out of that. That's what you do. Come up out of that.
That's your move?
That's the move.
That's the game winner.
That's it, baby, right there.
Check.
It's awesome that all these years later, I have people that come up and tell me all the time, you know, how much they loved the rivalry I had with Matt Hardy. And what a brilliant mind for professional wrestling. The things he's done over his career. And he's a great friend. When Matt and I had our very first match, it was in Baltimore, Maryland. And I'm like, all right, cool. You know, there's Matt Hardy here. Like, this is what's up, you know?
You and him are going to team up next week right here on SmackDown
to
take on Deuce and Domino.
I had no idea that we would be married to each other for the next year.
Philip, you become my partner, man.
Okay, you're kind of growing
on me. My homie.
Kind of growing on me, too. Homie, yeah.
Matt is still a good friend to this day, and it makes me very proud that so many people look back on that rivalry with so much adoration and appreciation.
And you know what? I think you're much better than the caddy.
Oh, I thought, man, I'm on TV now, making money. Probably shouldn't go to Miami right now. That wouldn't be like my best business decision. So I decided to move to Houston. I've been in Houston ever since. The WWE instituted a wellness program, and they discovered that I had an issue called Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, where in the electrical wiring of the heart, certain people have an extra circuit. Took me to a hospital in New York, and I met with some cardiologists, and they did what they call ablation therapy, where they go into the heart with a wire and they find that extra circuit, they zap it to kill it. It was scary at first, until I realized that, you know, I wasn't in danger of dying. It wasn't fatal, it wasn't career ending. And again, I have to say kudos to the WWE, because they discovered the issue and they jumped on it. You know, they covered all of my medical expenses. They saw to it that I was taken care of, got the best treatment. And here I am.
Man, I got to see these hands. When I used to box, I was undefeated, man. I could have been the next Muhammad Ali. Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee.
My body, my mind, my spirit, I just needed time out. So for that year off, I said, all right. And I decided, okay, I just need a break from pro wrestling. I was driving home, and I was driving past a sign that said, Jiu-Jitsu MMA. Gracie Baja. I pulled in, I asked a few questions, and I said, all right, sign me up. And that was the beginning of my journey in jiu-jitsu. You know, I had learned things from Norman Smiley and Josh Barnett. Just guys along the way had taught me a few little things, you know, grappling. And I was always fascinated by it. No pro wrestling, nothing else. I'm going to immerse myself in Brazilian jiu-jitsu. And I fell in love.
This is my jiu-jitsu professor, Andre Santos, and he has done wonders for my jiu-jitsu game. But the cool thing is, he's not just my teacher, he's become my friend, and he always has time.
We trained together about 7 years. He is already purple belt, because he's a busy guy, you know, but he's a competitor. And then I promote him a little bit faster than regular students.
I've done a number of tournaments. I'm very proud to say that I've won the Houston Open multiple times. I've won the Dallas Open, I've won the Austin Open.
This top shelf is pretty much mine.
I'm actually going to compete at the World Championships. I've been to the World Championships twice before.
The jewel, the crown jewel that I'm going for in Las Vegas is an IBJJF World Championship. And I've always been real tenacious. Not with all of my other accomplishments, I want to add that World Championship gold.
The actual competition breaks down to age, weight, and experience. So you're usually going up against people in your age bracket, your weight class, and your experience level. In Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, when you hit 30, then you go into what they call the Masters Division. So I competed in the Masters Division. I love it. I absolutely love it. I love stepping on the mat, squaring off with another practitioner.
Getting the silver. I always feel like I didn't win a silver, I lost a gold. When I found out that my opponent in the final for the gold was a four-time Judo Olympian and didn't take me down, I feel a lot better about the silver. A lot better.
I have to say, right now, I'm in a wonderful place in life. I'm 45 years old. I'm in great shape, but psychologically and emotionally, I feel great. I'm a dad, my son will be 5 in October, but I learned that I'm capable of the kind of love I didn't even know existed. I mean, you hear parents talking about the love that they have for a child, and you can kind of empathize, but until you actually experience it, you know, when I see my son go, Daddy, Daddy, look, I'm you. You know, naturally there's a part that goes, wow, that's pretty cool. WWE is bringing a super show to Houston, and I haven't been to a show in a while. I haven't been backstage, and I'm gonna stop by, and I'm gonna say hi to some of the boys.
Came up, man.
Started from the bottom, now we're here.
Yeah.
It's really cool. Getting to see some old faces.
the champ, Kofi Kingston, Shelton, Joe, Randy, I mean, just, and a bunch of new faces. I made some new friends today. So it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. And that sense of nostalgia came over. So I had a good time. I was a kid from the hood, poverty, government cheese, food stamps, you know? To go from that to becoming an ex-convict where, you know, I've said this many times, society wouldn't give me a chance to earn minimum wage, to actually have had the opportunity that I did with WWE and allowed me to become an international wrestling star.